India was the jewel in the crown.
British people living in India would be living lives of extraordinary opulence.
Britain is about to leave the greatest territory in its empire.
At the stroke of the midnight hour, India will awake to life and freedom.
But with the clock ticking towards independence, neighbors become mortal enemies in a fight for land and power.
Gosh, it's very sad stuff.
And she had this huge gaping wound in her forehead, you know.
1 million people are killed in a year. Partition is etched in blood and made in blood.
For the first time, colorized archive and private documents will tell the story of the personal rivalries between the key players at the center of partition, Nehru, Jinnah, and Mountbatten.
There were love affairs, there were antagonisms, there was distrust.
Jinnah very much sees Nehru as this kind of idealist upstart. They didn't like him one bit.
I think they both generally thought this man was a psycho.
Mountbatten's wife was having an affair with Nehru, the new Prime Minister of India.
What impact did their relationships have on one of the 20th century's greatest catastrophes?
As you would imagine in any vast tragedy like this, there's plenty of blame to go around.
There is a decision made, and it just shows the lack of value for Indian life.
It is not done and dusted. It is something people debate over, fight over, perhaps occasionally even kill over.
Out of London come new developments in Britain's plan for a changing empire. Under Prime Minister Attlee, the government of the United Kingdom shapes a new policy for freeing India. The policies of Ernest Bevin and Attlee have been sharply attacked by conservatives.
In spring 1946, following 6 years of war, Britain is bankrupt. After decades of Gandhi's protest movement, Indian independence is finally within reach.
The Attlee government wanted to be rid of India, they needed to be rid of India, it was becoming a financial drain.
It's both British resources and resolve that have been lost during World War II. They're victorious, but they're exhausted. The country's desperate to rebuild itself, and it just isn't pragmatic to hold on to it anymore.
So the deal was just get out of there with as little collateral damage as possible and making it look as good as possible.
In March 1946, the British send a committee to agree terms with the leaders of India's biggest political parties.
The fate of 400 million Indians rests on these men's shoulders. Iron-willed Muslim leaguer Mohammed Ali Jinnah debates India's future with silver-tongued Pandit Nehru, voice of the Congress Party.
The Nehru-Jinnah story is at the heart of India's endgame of empire. It's a captivating story. It divides Indians. You know, who do you like more? These two men would be antagonists who have huge egos that are also kind of gladiatorially fighting out for their ideas. These names have become shorthands for different ideologies, different viewpoints, different ideas of the future of India and Pakistan. Nehru famously, ironically, is associated as the last Englishman to have ruled over India because he was steeped in English education.
He was beloved whenever he went out campaigning. Huge crowds of people would come to see him.
My grandfather, V.P. Menon, greatly admired Nehru for his eloquence. But he also regarded Nehru as being a volatile, often irrational man who was given to acts of great impetuosity.
Nehru's goal from the very beginning had been a united and secular India that included the entire subcontinent, one in which, you know, it did not matter which religion you were. At the same time, he really did not appreciate the real fears of ordinary Muslims in India.
Jinnah feels that Nehru is only representing the interests of the Hindus. And Jinnah very much sees Nehru as this kind of political, naive, idealist upstart with whom he has a very much toxic relationship at this point.
Unlike an orthodox conventional Muslim, he ate pork and he was a connoisseur of good wine. He drank scotch. He smoked incessantly.
From the 1940s onwards, Jinnah had become increasingly sectarian. And the reason is very logical. He looks at the European experience and he says that minorities will be exterminated. That is what's happening in Europe. If India was going to be united with Hindus and Muslims living together, Indian Muslims would be constantly at the mercy of the Hindu majority. To prevent that from happening, the best way to safeguard Muslim interests was a separate country for Indian Muslims.
For weeks in New Delhi's sweltering heat, the British have met with India's leaders for an important diplomatic effort as India's two great parties, Congress and Muslim, search for an answer.
In June 1946, the UK government presents its draft plan for independent India to Nehru and Jinnah.
India would remain united. There would be a central government, but the real power would lie with each individual province.
Jinnah agrees because what the plan, according to Jinnah, does is to give him the Muslim majority provinces in the northeast, Bengal, and it gives him the province of the Punjab and the northwest frontier provinces. Those places would have almost complete sovereignty in deciding all of their affairs. And Jinnah thinks that that is essentially Pakistan in a nutshell. Nehru completely disagrees with the interpretation that Jinnah has given and says that he will not feel bound by either the words or the spirit of the plan.
Nehru essentially said, we're signing this now in order to get independence, and then once the British are gone, we will do as we please.
When Jinnah hears about Nehru, he's entirely outraged.
It reaffirmed all his fears about Congress, of course. And it also made him look weak.
Jinnah withdraws his acceptance of the plan. The British government's negotiations fall apart.
And it really then forces Jinnah's hand, and he realizes that there has to be a kind of a demonstration of mass public will for his idea. He says, well, I do not wish to discuss ethics any longer. We have a pistol. Now, this is a phenomenal statement.
There's a resolution passed at the Muslim League meeting that says on August 16th, in 1946, there will be direct action day, and it's going to be a strike, an all-day strike by Muslims all over India that's going to show the power of the demand for Pakistan. He's resolving to unleash the power of the masses and see what message that sends to Congress after this betrayal that he perceives.
He doesn't clearly define what direct action stands for, and only very much later does he say that he thinks that direct action does mean a peaceful protest. But of course, direct action starts to mean different things for different people.
It has a kind of triggering effect. It's a pressure tactic which becomes immediately incredibly violent.
Calcutta was a huge city. It had been bombed during the war. There were lots and lots of leftover weapons. You know, I think people were just on edge.
Calcutta was always going to be one of the flashpoints of the coming struggle because it is a city which has, although a majority Hindu population, it's in Bengal, which has a majority Muslim population. So there is, if you like, a genuine sort of nervousness, a genuine fear of what might happen.
People were mainly gathering in peaceful demonstrations, and they were largely adhering to what Jinnah had told them, that this is going to be a peaceful hartal, a peaceful strike. But then groups of Hindus and Muslims run into each other.
Muslim protesters start crossing the river, coming into central Calcutta to attend this protest. Hindus from buildings along the route that they were walking would throw bricks down at them, flower pots. So there were tensions bubbling, there was anger. But even then, at the end of that first day, the attacks were scattered, they're in different parts of the city. What happened then, though, that night, much bigger gangs of people, in a more organized fashion, started going through these tiny little lanes and setting fire to the homes of minorities.
The first victim I saw was a poor porter, Hindu, and he had just come into this side street, and there, a Muslim in a lungi broke away from a procession with an iron rod and hit him on the head.
Every other grounding for your identity has ceased to matter, and all that matters is, are you Hindu, are you Muslim? You're either with us or against us.
In our area where we used to live, any stranger coming in, they wanted to find out whether he was a Hindu or not. If he was not a Hindu, he was murdered on the spot.
And in the morning, when the sun came up, there were bodies everywhere.
Trouble flared up in an orgy of looting and stabbing during the worst riots in the history of Calcutta, following the direct action call by Mr. Jinnah, leader of the Muslim League. Fires raged unchecked in many places while pitched battles continued between Muslims and Hindus.
These were gangs attacking defenseless people. It became almost a free-for-all. And then it was either you killed or you would be killed.
One of the Hindu gang leaders, Gopal Patta Mukherjee, instructed his gang members they must kill 10 Muslims for every Hindu who was killed, and instructed them to use any implements they could. And the Muslim gangs have a horrible habit. They will tie Hindus to poles and drill a hole in their forehead so they slowly bleed to death through the brain. It just sort of complete killing for the sake of killing, wanton killing.
I saw children being thrown out of second floor flats of the houses, and I've seen people being speared to death. I've seen Muslims kill Hindus. I've seen Hindus kill Muslims.
By the 21st of August, 15,000 people lie injured and an estimated 10,000 are killed. It takes 5 days for enough British troops to be deployed to quell the violence.
The British governor in Bengal took a long time calling in troops. This is an immense loss of life that they have the resources to prevent. And there is a decision made not to do that. And it just shows the lack of value for Indian life among British colonial administrators.
And here, I think we cannot take out that this is a triangular story, where the rules of the game have been set by the British. The British Empire in India was highly brutal. It was incredibly violent.
Time and time again during colonial history, there's an absolute priority to protect British life rather than Indian life. Indian life is not as valuable, it's not as important.
It's racist. It's not a concern with the safety and well-being of Indian lives.
And this is where the idea of divide and rule comes in. India is, of course, one of the most diverse parts of the world, a melting pot of multi-religiosity. It also houses the largest Muslim population in the world. And, of course, you also have Hindus and Sikhs.
It becomes sort of a pillar of British policy that they want to ensure that Hindus and Muslims and various groups in India do not unite against British rules. So they want to try and deepen any fault lines between these communities and keep them more and more at odds, intensify whatever differences exist.
And this sets up a kind of competitive, antagonistic relationship between the two communities. So literally, the Indians are set free to kill each other without the British taking any responsibility for the civil war that has in fact been unleashed in large parts due to the policies that they have prosecuted.
During that time, not a single leader from the Congress or the Muslim League went to Calcutta. They didn't go there to try and calm down their followers or to try and restore peace. Both of them use this almost as a way to attack each other, as a justification for their arguments. Many, many people fled the city after the violence, and they would go back to their home villages or to neighboring provinces, and they would spread tales of what had happened. Horrible detail about the way they'd been treated by the other community. Rumors spread faster than fact, right?
Noakhali is a bloodbath. It spreads through the United Provinces, Bihar, it reaches Punjab. It is like a wave of insanity, if you like, which is all fed by fear.
And it suddenly brings home, certainly to the British government, and I think also to Congress and to Jinnah, just what could happen. India is rapidly beginning to spiral out of control. How much further could this go? What could we actually be dealing with? So it is a wake-up call.
With violence now beginning to spread across northern India, the British government announces the appointment of a new viceroy, a decision that would affect the lives of millions.
It's very interesting why Mountbatten was picked. He was a member of the royal family. He was a man who had charm, who was able to get on with people. He was a doer rather than a thinker, and the time for doing things had come.
He had been Commander-in-Chief of the Southeast Asian Command during the last days of the war and took the Japanese surrender in Singapore.
He had a pretty bad reputation in the Admiralty. He, in fact, was nicknamed the Master of Disaster for his ability to crash warships and generally smash up ordnance.
He was immensely good-looking, but he was also immensely vain. When you heard him speak, it was as if he'd won the entire war single-handed.
Even though this job was quite clearly a poison chalice, it was obviously impossible to come out of it well. It was that vanity that he could be Viceroy of India, this immense office, that he couldn't quite say no.
Prelude to Lord Mountbatten's departure was a farewell reception at India House. Many distinguished officials gathered for a friendly chat with the Viceroy designate, taking up office at a momentous period of Indian history.
On the 20th of March, 1947, Mountbatten leaves the UK to take up his new appointment as Viceroy.
Mountbatten had been to India before, but beyond that, his knowledge of India was minimal.
It's not unusual in some ways to appoint a Viceroy who doesn't have in-depth knowledge of India, but for such a role, for the last task of winding up the Indian Empire, it was quite incredible.
Mountbatten's appointment comes with a looming deadline. The British government wants to be out of India no later than June 1948.
It was an incredibly short space of time to wind up Britain's most important and most vast possession, namely the Indian Empire.
So actually those personal relationships became very intensely important because it was this incredibly focused, tiny group of people on a rapidly speeding up clock that really had to resolve a situation that was basically intractable. So likes, dislikes, loves and hates became magnified in their importance.
The Mountbattens' own unconventional marriage would soon come to have a profound impact on political events.
Edwina Mountbatten had been born into considerable wealth, and she really became one of the world's richest, most desirable heiresses.
She was glamorous, she was stylish, she was slightly edgy, she was completely a free spirit.
Lord Mountbatten himself said that he and Lady Mountbatten had spent most of their married life hopping in and out of other people's beds. And she seems to have been far more prolific than Mountbatten himself was, although he was not averse at all to having a few affairs on the side himself. By the standards of today, this is something that is regarded as faintly shocking. But it was not by the standards of their day and their class.
Of course, when the Mountbattens went to India, this semi-open marriage they had would reach a new level and start a very large scandal.
New Delhi airfield and the arrival of the Viceroy designate. He was received by the military secretary on behalf of Lord Wavell, the retiring Viceroy.
The Mountbattens arrived into Delhi. Mountbatten in full dress with medals all the way across his breastbone. The Mountbattens were sworn in as Viceroy and Viceroyin in Durbar Hall, and them sitting on these two extraordinary thrones, really to represent British royalty in its height of pageantry.
This person as Viceroy had more power than any Prime Minister, more than any other colonial official in history, and ruled over more people than anyone else had. They had the power of life and death.
On the streets outside of Viceroy's house, the situation is deteriorating.
When Mountbatten comes to India, you have a large number of Indian cities in repeated and quite brutal clashes between communities. Above all, Delhi, which is the political capital, is seeing large-scale violence, and this would just get amplified over the coming months.
In Rawalpindi, there are major attacks against Hindus and Sikhs, including forced mass conversions of people who comply out of fear for their lives. There's a lot of violence against women, especially, which takes many forms, including rape, mutilation, abductions. The violence includes a lot of suicides of women preemptively killing themselves so as not to be dishonored.
You see, we were standing by the well where the women who had jumped into the well, their bodies had come up, bloated. It was a gruesome spectacle. Somebody standing by my side would say, that was my wife and that was my sister and so on and so forth.
The news of what's happening in Rawalpindi triggers other kinds of violence elsewhere in Punjab, in Lahore, in Amritsar and so on. People are living in terror.
Shortly after arriving in India, Edwina heads to Rawalpindi to witness the unfolding crisis.
Edwina might have been seen as a kind of socialite in the 1920s, but when she went to India, she was very active in the refugee camps. She really did get involved with some quite difficult work, making those works, setting them up, administering them, helping people who were in them, and so on.
You have these two elements going on at the same time, heightened, very hot conflagrations on the streets. People have gotten up and killed their neighbors and driven out the minorities of their villages. But at the same time, you have this kind of cool, cold logic of constitutional consultations going on in the corridors of power.
British power was rapidly being eroded. The whole edifice was beginning to crumble. And I think Dickey just felt that there would be no power to give if they didn't move quickly.
On the same day that Mountbatten is officially sworn in, he invites Nehru to Viceroy House.
Viceroy interviews number 3, 24th of March, 1947. Pundit Nehru struck me as most sincere, with a fairness of mind.
Nehru was very easy to get along with, a bit of an operator. I mean, I think he and Mountbatten could see a lot of very similar characteristics.
They found a friendship, not least because Nehru got the subtleties and the nuances of the language.
The most important thing is they agreed on what they wanted. Both Nehru and Mountbatten wanted a united India.
The friendship between Nehru and Mountbatten had started a year earlier.
The Mountbattens and Nehru had first met in Singapore in 1946.
Nehru was coming to Singapore, where Edwina and Dickey were based. So he went out and met him at the airport. He brought him to a welfare center where Edwina was working to meet her. And the place was packed.
Lady Mountbatten was kind of in danger of being trampled. And so Nehru shouted to Mountbatten, "Your wife, we've got to go to her." And they sort of picked her up between the two of them and marched her out of there.
That created, I think, a great bond between the three of them. But I think it's very clear that there was an instant attraction between Edwina and Nehru. I mean, there are pictures of a few days after they arrive of Nehru sitting at her feet.
It's a sort of extraordinarily relaxed pose to be in straight away. There were already rumours circulating within a week of the Mountbatten's arrival in India, that there was something going on between Lady Mountbatten and Nehru.
And this is the kind of thing that Jinnah would see from afar and would really fuel his suspicions about what Mountbatten and the Mountbattens were concocting with Nehru and the Congress. Definitely made him more paranoid than he might otherwise have been.
The great perception among particularly the Muslims was that there was a favoritism going on. Right from the very beginning, the Mountbattens were not absolutely even-handed as they should have been.
It's not until almost 2 weeks after seeing Nehru that Mountbatten first meets with Jinnah.
Jinnah went into these conversations with Mountbatten very well prepared in order to bring across his point that he wanted a separate sovereign nation state for Indian Muslims. But what he found out is that the Viceroy was more interested in having nice social conversations in order to produce intimacy.
This is an account of the meeting with Jinnah on the 5th of April 1947, so right at the very beginning. And he writes, "When Mr. Jinnah arrived, he was in a most frigid, haughty, and disdainful frame of mind. For half an hour more, he made monosyllabic replies to my attempts at conversation." And I think this sums up the relationship. It was like a game of tennis where the ball wasn't being returned.
Jinnah was being Jinnah at his worst. He was intransigent, He was intractable. He refused to succumb to what Mountbatten had always deployed very successfully, his charm onslaught. Mountbatten was left astonished.
To Mountbatten, having a drink with his friends would amount to the same thing as being able to do politics. And that is, of course, a very sort of chummy London club scene sort of attitude. And it worked very well with somebody like Nehru. But with Jinnah, that didn't work at all. It's really sad because he thinks that's how politics is done. It's actually such a tragedy. God.
Once Mountbatten realizes he can't charm Jinnah, he in some ways tries to demonize him to make Jinnah look like he's being highly unreasonable, highly unfair, and frankly mad, so that it makes it easier to push forward his plans and his ideas because Jinnah is such an impossible person.
We have this meeting from literally a week later. And he writes, "I regard Jinnah as a psychopathic case. In fact, until I'd met him, I would not have thought it possible that a man with such a complete lack of administrative knowledge or sense of responsibility could achieve or hold down so powerful a position." So even within a week, the relationship has got a lot worse.
I've never seen another historical figure being called a madman this frequently. And then when you look at his demands, they're sober, rational demands. None of his demands are crazy. He looks at the European experience and he says that minorities will be exterminated. That is what's happening in Europe. So if I don't get my own country for the Muslim minority, we will not have a Muslim minority to talk about in 100 years' time.
Four weeks later, Mountbatten has devised a plan for Indian independence. Plan Balkan, as it's known, is approved in London. It has not been discussed with any of the Indian leaders.
Plan Balkan was Mountbatten's great plan to fragment and divide India before the British left. Power being transferred to a dozen, perhaps 13, provincial governments. My grandfather, V.P. Menon, was fully aware, firstly, that Plan Balkan would decimate India, and more importantly, in a way, was that neither the Congress Party nor the Muslim League would ever accept it.
May 1947 is a very interesting point because they're all feeling very tired. Dickie's has had dysentery. They all go to rest and recover in Shimla.
Shimla was the summer capital of the British Raj. It's up in the foothills of the Himalayas in a spectacularly beautiful location. Incredibly dramatic scenery. So it really feels a bit like the Garden of Eden up in these mountainsides.
The events in Simla in May 1947 are vital importance in the story of the partition because they resulted in the geographical map of the world changing. Lady Mountbatten suggested my grandfather come up to Simla as well. But the Mountbattens had a surprising guest with them, Nehru.
So immediately, of course, that was a sort of fairly intimate little kind of trip away that Jinnah was now not invited to.
Now, Dickie should be, in a sense, above the fray. He should be with his advisors, but he should not be socializing with one of the key players, Nehru. But he takes Nehru with him, and there are wonderful accounts of Nehru standing on his head and walking backwards up the hill, and he seems like he's one of the family, really, there.
There was a meeting of minds, particularly between Edwina and Nehru.
Nehru wrote to Lady Mountbatten long afterwards remembering this time when their attachment had become extremely close in India. And I'll quote from it, if I may. "Suddenly I realized, and perhaps you did also, that there was a deeper attachment between us, that some uncontrollable force of which I was only dimly aware drew us to one another. We talked more intimately, as if some veil had been removed, and we could look into each other's eyes without fear or embarrassment."
These are two key players in the partition of India, crucial moment in 20th century history.
This relationship between them was a conduit, we know, for political discussion and for the kind of negotiation that was going on.
They were having their own intimate relationship, the two of them, but there were three in that relationship. And of course, there were stories that Mountbatten and Nehru were attracted to each other on quite a romantic level. And you see pictures of the three of them in the back of sports cars, almost like some sort of threesome.
In a top secret memo that Mountbatten wrote, he says, "I had a distinct hunch that I ought to take advantage of my newfound friendship with Nehru to ask his personal opinion of the new draft," Mountbatten referring to Plan Balkan. "For some extraordinary reason, going against the advice of my grandfather, going against the advice of all his other senior advisors, Mountbatten decided to show it to Nehru."
So not only did Mountbatten take Nehru up to Shimla, but he also shared top secret documents with him that Nehru then, of course, had an opportunity to react to.
"Much as my grandfather predicted, Nehru spent the night in a fury."
Mountbatten is playing loose and fast with his relationships and is not behaving in the sort of completely impartial way that he should be.
Mountbatten failed miserably, and he failed miserably by playing favorites.
Well, Nehru convinced Mountbatten that he was going to have to redo the plan without any input from any of the other leaders.
"My grandfather received urgent summons to Viceroy Lord. When he arrived, he found Lady Mountbatten holding Mountbatten's hand, both looking completely shattered. It was at this point that my grandfather said, 'Would you like me to flesh out my alternative plan?' Mountbatten agreed, armed with a bottle of whiskey and several packets of cigarettes. My grandfather duly produced the plan, handed it on to first to Mountbatten, who gave it to Nehru to read. The Menon plan differed radically from Plan Balkan in that instead of transferring power to a dozen or more provincial governments, power would be transferred to two countries, India and to Pakistan."
Mountbatten took advantage of this relationship between Edwina and Nehru by using her to sell him the partition plan. So she was his right-hand person in terms of playing this relationship.
To his enormous relief, Nehru agreed to the Menon plan. Mountbatten was ecstatic.
It's quite crazy that, speaking of the fortune of over 400 million people, and literally that could mean life and death for hundreds of thousands of these people, that it's effectively decided in a plush room in the hills of India in Shimla by three men.
Mountbatten, being Mountbatten, immediately took credit for it. And that is the plan that has come down to be known as the Mountbatten plan. In point of fact, Mountbatten had nothing whatsoever to do with it at all. It was VP Menon. It was his plan. In Mountbatten's last honors list, he offered my grandfather the highest level of knighthood then available within the Indian order. And my grandfather very politely declined it. But as he later on told his daughter-in-law, my mother, how could I accept a knighthood for being the man who devised the partition of my country?
Momentous days as the Viceroy holds vital talks with the leaders to discuss the transfer of power to Indian hands. As the thermometer blazes up to 112 degrees outside, Pandit Nehru and other delegates have a short word with Viscount Mountbatten before the talks begin.
As all the Indian leaders gather at Viceroy's house to be presented with the new plan for independence, Jinnah is unaware that Nehru has already seen and approved it.
So on the 2nd of June, Mountbatten asked all the Indian leaders to come and meet with him, and he showed them the plan for the first time, and he actually gave them a deadline of midnight to come back to him with any problems about it. He thought it was very crucial to give them as little time as possible, potentially, to object to the plan. Well, Jinnah looked at this plan and decided that, in fact, there were some problems with it.
The reason that he wasn't happy with the plan that Mountbatten proposed to him was that Pakistan will consist of two wings, and in the middle you have 1,500 kilometers of India, and both of Bengal and Punjab are going to be split up. And Jinnah has always been very outspoken that the last thing that he wants is a partitioning of these two regions.
Obviously, both Nehru and Mountbatten would have preferred India to stay united, but there may have been, you know, in the back of their minds, certainly in the back of Nehru's mind, might have been the idea that, well, if this Pakistan really is so unviable, perhaps in a few years, they will change their mind and they will decide to reunite with India.
So this is Mountbatten's account that he records many years later on the crucial meeting he has on the 2nd of June with Muhammad Ali Jinnah. This was probably the most hair-raising moment of my entire life, waiting to see if that clot was going to nod or shake his head. It shows outright contempt that Mountbatten was feeling towards Jinnah. He was trying to sort of recount how he was the real heroic figure in this grand debate. But there is no doubt that he did bully Jinnah into agreeing to the partition plan.
I think there's a sense that Jinnah is negotiating with one hand behind his back. He is not privy to information at the same time as Nehru, indeed perhaps not privy to some of the information at all.
Because he had pushed for Pakistan so hard, it would have been very hard for him to turn down even this truncated Pakistan. I don't think his supporters would have allowed it.
Jinnah is forced to accept this plan because he thought that it was important to acquire a Muslim homeland, whatever the cost. He calls it truncated, he calls it moth-eaten. He's not happy with the Pakistan that he gets.
When the talks finished, Lord Louis, whose masterly and tactful handling of the situation reflected the cheerful atmosphere prevailing, makes his long-awaited broadcast to an expectant world.
I want to give a personal message to the people of India. To my great regret, it has been impossible to obtain agreement on any plan that will preserve the unity of India. And the only alternative is partition. The exact split will be left to the Boundary Commission. The whole plan may not be perfect, but like all plans, its success will depend on the spirit of goodwill with which it is carried out.
Well, Mountbatten is here finally saying, well, partition is coming, but he isn't saying what it means, which is pretty important detail to leave out, in the sense that these two huge new states were going to come into being without knowing their own borders.
The way that partition is announced sends a shockwave through India. The big question is, all right, okay, fine, you're going to do this, but where is the line going to go? Who's going to go where? Who's going to be in Pakistan? Who's going to be in India? What are they meant to move their houses? What are they meant to uproot their farms? What's going to happen? There's confusion and there's fear. And from fear, often you get violence.
Mountbatten then reveals an even more disturbing aspect to his plans.
He then makes an extraordinary statement. Independence will not be June 1948, but it'll be August the 15th, 1947.
That's 73 days. 73 days to create two new countries with two different identities. It sounds insane because it is insane. You know, it was a roll of the dice, and the gamble is at the cost of human life.
And that really sparks off the endgame in the most violent fashion.
No one imagined that these intricately mixed communities were somehow going to be ethnically cleansed, and in a very permanent way.
The very leaders who had been so powerful in changing the course of history, in producing the end of empire, will find themselves helpless in the face of mass violence.
The series continues next Sunday at the same time. Then at 10 o'clock, blurring the lines between the good guys and the bad, shocking and violent atrocities committed by colonial forces, secret history presents a very British way of torture.